Okay, so praise God, everyone, and thank you, Papa, for giving me an opportunity. I thank God as well for giving me an opportunity to share what He has been teaching me all this time. So my name is Ron. I'm from Bangalore, India. I just wanted to share with you, beginning from a testimony of what God has done in my life and how He saved me, which actually costed my life, my entire life, at the age of 21. So I knew, I met Brother Johnson. I was a part of JCILM team from the year 2007, way back when Brother Johnson had come to Bangalore. And I'm brought up from a complete Orthodox family where we attend retreats, where we are forced to attend retreat or forced to go to church, you know, forced to pray. But without any specific meaning or without knowing the knowledge of what exactly we get or why we are doing what we are doing. Now, it so happened in the same phase of life, we met Brother Johnson. And when he was talking about the word, it was just usual for me because I used to attend retreats and I know, okay, fine, this is the same thing that I have heard. There's nothing different as in. But when I started to listen to him, when he started to break the word and make it applicable practically in my life, in this current situation, it made more sense for me. And that is where I started.
How old were you that time?
I was 17.
You were 20?
17.
17, okay.
2007, yeah.
And from when, at what age you were going to retreats before that?
I was going to retreats 10, 11 years because my father's brother, he was also in a prayer meeting. So we were taken to Porta, we were taken to RRC, a Renewal Retreat Center in Bangalore.
So from the age of 10, you are right inside the house of God by force and you have been bombarded with the word of God.
Yeah, I do say it's by force because I didn't know the exact meaning or I didn't know why am I going. I was just pulled in because I didn't have that understanding of why and what. It is just because people are following, I need to follow.
You have got no option. Mom says, sit in the car. Yes, mom.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Now you are 17.
Yeah. So
okay. What happened?
When I started to listen and word of God made more sense to me, I started to understand or spend some time because all these things that I have learned did not make some sense for me. The only thing, the question that I had in my mind is why is Jesus called a savior? He came, he died, he went. Why should you even think of a person who's died? Because at that age, at that maturity level, I didn't even know why should we worship Jesus. So all these questions were just running in my mind. And when the word of God was broken to me, and when Brother Johnson started explaining to me, I started to read the Bible. Not just read, but started to study the Bible.
Okay, Ron, 1 minute. You are saying, this is a very interesting question.
Yeah.
You are saying, all these years you had a question, why should I worship Jesus who has come, died on the cross, and is gone? So nobody gave you the reason why he died and how his death will save you, right?
Yes, exactly. I didn't know what is salvation why Jesus came.
Two, because when I came to Bangalore in the beginning, your sister Angeline, who most of the people know through the Sower and the Seed CD, who was suffering with a sickness, and she killed that sickness in 11 days. Right?
Yeah.
You mean to say her testimony did not make an effect, but understanding the word of God, why Jesus died for you, made you turn to the Bible?
No. 2007 is when even my sister met you along with me. So we were in the same phase. My sister did not experience the healing at that time still.
No. Because when I saw the first time, she was sitting on the second row. I will not agree with you. Baba, no. I will not agree with you. I will have to ask her. I will have to ask her because according to me, I have never seen her in any of my class.
Yeah, 2007 is when we were brought as children, me and my sister and my parents were brought to the place that we were.
Were you there when Angeline got the touch?
No.
Ah, okay. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So when these things happened and when I started to study the word, it made more sense for me. And I started to apply these words, take it very seriously and understand and ask the Holy Spirit how these words really affect me in my present life. How is Bible being in real for me in my present life than is just a storybook. So it just moved on, life moved on, but I was with the word in the sense applying it to what extent I need to apply. And it so happened in the last year of my engineering, we were friends, we were enjoying, and I met with an accident, going in the wrong way, being drunk.
Hold on. Don't give me like that story. I'm not interested.
Okay.
Why? What was the enjoyment? What was the reason why you met with an accident? We want to know that. Don't give half answers because the meaning changes completely. You are in the word, you are studying the word, and you met with an accident.
Yeah. Yes.
Before meeting the accident, what was the condition?
So I was in a condition where I had relationship with God.
Okay.
It is not that I didn't have. I was continuing in the word. I used to share the word with my friends.
Very good. Then, on that night, what happened?
On that night, when we had won the overall championship in my college, we, as friends, what happened was they started to, we started to have enjoyment in such a way that we started to drink.
Ah, so
that was the first time that I started to drink.
We started to drink. Okay, go ahead. Now comes the story is correct. Okay, go.
Yeah. So
I'm a lawyer, okay?
Yeah. So when I was drunk, I didn't know what I was exactly doing. Because even though when they offered me a drink, the only thought that came to my mind is Jesus has already forgiven you. So why not try even once in life? Because we have not never drunk. So that's the thought that made me, okay, fine, once in a lifetime, I'm not going anywhere, nor even I'm at my place, I'm in my friend's place, not even nobody will come to know. So I started to sip and I was drunk on that night. So when this happened, one of my friend in the middle of the night woke up and he told, we were around 26 people. So one of my friend in the middle of the night just woke up and he told, I want to drink a cup of coffee. Now, we were like wondering where will we get a cup of coffee at this time. So we decided to go to Mysore from Bangalore.
26 kilometers at 3 o'clock to go for coffee.
200 kilometers.
Two?
26 what? People. Yeah. So just to take a cup of coffee, we wanted to go around 200 kilometers. Because we were drunk and we were so happy.
This is called the height of foolishness. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, so on our way towards Mysore, that is where, even though I did not have the sense of driving or the conscious of driving, even though I was drunk, I just brushed my teeth so that I could not get caught while driving and then moved on. And the next moment I wake up, I recognize myself only after 3 months. So now in these 3 months, what happened is what I'm going to tell you. So the moment I met with an accident, I actually toppled out of the car when I was driving. When I toggled my car from left directly to the right direction, I toppled up. I fell on the car and I again went up and came down on the ground, landed on my left side of my body in such a way that my...
What's the speed of the car?
The speed of the car was around 120.
Okay. And with not right senses in your mind, you lost control and the car went somersault in the air and you went through the windscreen and landed on the bonnet and the car did not land once. It bounced again with the speed and you went along with the car on the top and landed again on the bonnet on the left side, right?
Yes, exactly right.
Okay.
So when I landed, my entire left side of my brain or my head was open and my left shoulder was completely, the nerves were completely damaged. So I didn't have conscious. That's when my friends, called ambulance because we were in multiple cars. So another people in another car.
And what about the others in the car?
Yeah, that's the best part. When the car landed, it was only I who jumped out of the car. Everybody were in the car. And when the car toppled and landed, it landed directly on the four wheels where nothing happened to all the four.
And only you are the one who got the hit.
Yeah, because I jumped out of the car.
You jumped out of the car or you went through the windscreen?
I jumped. Only my driver's seat window was open. So I jumped out of the car from the window.
Okay.
So when the car landed, all the four were safe. And when the car landed, it seems that they all opened the door and they ran from there, thinking the car would burst. So I was there in that spot and people from other car took a video of this. And that is where I came to know how the car landed. So they had called the ambulance. And once I was admitted to the hospital, I was in the ICU for 43 hours where doctors had given up hope. In the meantime, my family, my friends, and the JCLM team, everyone were informed about this incident. And when they came into the hospital, I did not even know who were there. I did not even know that I was alive, first thing. And in 43 hours, I believe these are the people that God put in my life, that they prayed. And I was out of ICU into a general ward where I had a sling on my left hand and complete stitches on my head from my forehead to the back, to exactly the center point of the head. So that is the condition that I was brought back to home, in a sense where I did not recognize that I was alive, nor I did not know what was my name, who were my parents. I did not know whether I was alive in the world, simple as that. So basically what happens when a left side of the brain is damaged, you forget your past. You forget, your entire memory is erased. And you don't even know what has happened just a minute back, because the ability to remember things is no more present or no more capable for you in your life. So that was the state I was brought in at home. So when this happened,
how long did you remain in coma?
I'd not say that it is coma, but because the only thing that I can say is I don't remember what was happening to me at that time. All these things were explained to me. And when I regained my senses, that is where I saw pictures of mine, what was going on those days when I did not even have a sense of remembering.
Okay.
So when I came home, it seems that my mom and dad used to come and ask me, who am I? I did not even know he's my dad, she's my mom. I did not even recognize my own name. And according to the report, doctor had given up hope, saying that, because he's young, because I was 21 years old at that time, he would automatically recover, no need of surgery. So we will give him some time. We will see to that he'll recover to an extent where he can recover. So my mom started to ask my sister, who is also a doctor back in Australia, and having her inputs, having the input of the world from doctors, she started to teach me A for apple, B for ball. Everything in my system had to be re-educated from top to bottom, which means...
Doing your engineering of the last year and you now start again from the nursery.
Yeah. So, which means my mom...
Nursery also, but with a very, very bad memory that you can't even remember who your mom is. It's very, very bad.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I can't even tell you as nursery because, say, for example, you have been taught A for apple today. Maybe after a week, if you ask the child what is A for apple, she can remember. But I was not in a state to remember as well. So every day was for A for apple for me because I was not able to remember the previous day that was taught to me. So that was the situation, that was the condition that I was in when I was brought to a home. And I used to never remember what was fed to me. I was just fed and I was given bath. I was taken every step that I walk. There was a person who had to handle me. to go from from one source to another destination. So these were the things that was happening, and people started to pray over me. And praise be to God for my mom, dad, for all my family members and the GCLM family. When I speak about family, everyone who stood for me in the gap and started to intercede and pray for me. And it so happened in just a matter of 2 months, I started to recover my memory. I started to recognize, okay, my name is Ron. Okay, he is my dad. Okay, she is my mom. Okay, I was studying engineering. What happened to me? So all these things I started to recognize, I started to realize, and I started to gain my memory back supernaturally. And it was like, the moment they started asking me what had happened to you, I don't remember. Because I don't remember even now, I don't remember anything about the incident that happened. I only remember after 2 months of my life, how I was. So in 2 months, supernaturally, I started to recover my memory and I started to know, okay, where I was, who was I in the world, and started to use whatever I had in my life. Now, in this situation of my life, when I started to regain my memory back, I dwelt completely on the word of God because I didn't have anything to do. Because I knew...
But how did you know that I have to depend on the word of God?
Because back in 2007 is when started to explain to me. Sorry?
So that memory got restored in 2007, how you were got into...
Yes, yes. Yes, exactly.
In other words, that means the memory was recovered in you was a selective memory. Not all. Some were recovered. And one of that was that how the word of God works.
Yeah. I did not even remember anything that happened on the accident night. Other than that, everything that has happened to me, especially when it comes to the word of God, because that is the most of the time that I used to spend with the word. To be frank, from 2007 is when I started to join my engineering, and my home to my college, it was 2 hours journey. And in this 2 hours, one way, 2 hours journey, every day, 4 hours, Sower in the Seed, completely, I would have listened to Sower in the Seed for 4 times. The entire CD I would have completed 4 times in this entire 4 years. So not missing any track. So this was very strong in my mind. I had to dwell on something that I already had.
Roll. One minute. You mean to say, out of all these things, the Sower and the Seed CD, you are listening for 4 hours while going for your engineering college for 4 years, and that is what was strongest in your mind, and when the memory came, those things were the first to get registered in your new mind or the recovered mind. So now you began to remember the word of God.
Yes, exactly. Because that was the priority in all these 4 years. So my life had taken, the word of God had taken a priority in my life. So whenever I started to regain my memory, the first thing that was top of my mind was the word.
Okay. Then...
So when I came to know, okay, fine, now I need to depend on the word, because of all the testimonies of all the word that you had shared, I know how it works. I know that I'm already in a situation that I am right now in, and I need to go to a situation where God promises to. So keeping that in mind, I started slow by slow again to listen to the same Sower and the Seed, revising my memory and remembering what and all I had learned these 4 years. Now, in the meantime, I also had to attend my engineering of the last semester, where I had only a few days to attend because rest of the days I was at home recovering of my memory. When I started to attend my engineering and depend on the word of God, study my subjects, depend on the word of God, started to confess, at that point of time, my priority was to complete my engineering and pass it out instead of failing in the last semester. So that was my concentration point at that time. So I depend on the word of God. I started to take scriptures, especially 1 Corinthians 2:16, which says that I have the mind of Christ and the wisdom of God is found within me. Keeping this in mind, and whenever I study my subjects, I wouldn't get it in the first place, but I used to tell myself that, listen, Raul, I have the mind of Christ. You mean to say mind of Christ cannot understand what I'm studying? You mean to say mind of Christ do not even know what is there in the textbook? Come on, the person who's written the textbook is also being blessed by God, and that God, that mind of the God is within you. So these are my understanding, the understanding that I took from the word. You know, faith, all you are taught is that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So when that came into reality, like the word started talking to me, saying that I am the Christ and I am the one who blessed the mind of the author who has written the textbook, and that mind is inside of me. So when this type of understanding started to come.
Say that again, please. Say that again slowly.
Okay. So the word started talking to me, saying, Raul, listen, I am the Christ, and I am the Christ who blessed the author who has to write this book for which you need to study for the exam. Now, if I have blessed the author and given him the mind to study, the same mind is within you. Now, when this understanding came to me, I was like, okay, so even before author could write, these things were in the mind of Christ, and the same mind is within me. So it is not difficult for me to understand. So with that understanding, I started to study. I started to tell myself, okay, come on, if author knows, even I should know, because the same mind of Christ has been given to him and me. Now, these are the things that helped me go and on and study and study. And I used to remember it in such a way, keeping the word in focus. And I start. I gained a lot of insights, because at that point, the only person who could save me was Jesus. At that point, the only destination or the only person or the only power.
In other words, there was no other option. Not only
no other option.
Every time Jesus is the only source, but what happens is when the options are open, we want to take other options as well. But here you had no other option but to depend on Jesus, because all the options are closed.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So that's the only time that that's the only person that I could depend. So I started to do that, and eventually I could see flourishing in my subjects. I wrote my exams, came out with distinction going to exams. And
okay.
Believe me, it was
interesting. It's interesting. Between the accident and the semester, how many years?
4 months.
What?
4 months.
So
one semester.
Between the accident and your memory coming is 2 months.
Yeah.
So in the next 2 months, you installed the memory chip in such a way that you got through the exam in 2 months with a distinction, starting with A for Apple.
Yes. It's supernatural. That's what, you know, people can come and they can see my incident, which is their photographs with the date and the time and my engineering certificate. It is supernatural.
Okay, now that is of the education, academics. Now, every person who is in medical science knows that when a nerve is dead, it is dead forever. No medical science can ever make the nerve alive. So
yeah.
How many nerves were dead in your body because of that accident?
So when I fell from the car, I fell on my left shoulder, on my left side.
Okay.
So now that my memory was regained, my left hand was not responding because there was an injury called brachial plexus, which means there are a group of nerves which join, which come to a point from where the entire action of the arm takes place. So when I fell exactly on the point where the group of nerves join. And when I fell on the ground, the entire nerves were stretched. Some were stretched, some were cut, some were dislocated.
There was not one nerve damage. The joint or the hub where all the distribution takes place, that hub itself was totally damaged.
Yes, exactly right.
So when the hub is damaged, there's no more communication going from the brain to the final organ. Because the hub, the distribution center only is blown off. It is like exploded. So there's no connection now with the brain to the final organ.
Yes. So basically, what happens is the nerve carries the pulses, which holds the muscles. So the nerve is dead. There is no pulses. So the muscles have gone off.
My
So
God.
the nerve. So that was a condition. The next thing that I started to focus on. So when I started to regain, now these are the scriptures that I would give you. But before going to that, on this phase, what I wanted to tell or share is if any one of you or in your children or in your workplace, if you are a teacher, if any one of you think that it is not possible to clear a subject or to achieve something that you God has put or God has put a desire in your heart, for sure I'll tell you, when you have this mind of saying to yourself that the mind of Christ who has authored the subject is already inside of you. With this understanding, when you try to study, things become more real, things become more easy, things become more natural for you to accept.
Studies. What was your prayer for your studies? Marina, just write it down, please. Yeah, go
One
ahead.
Corinthians 2:16.
1 Corinthians 2:16. What was your prayer?
I have the mind of Christ and the wisdom of
I
God.
have the mind of Christ. Marina, I have the mind of Christ
And the wisdom of God
and the wisdom of God
is formed within me.
is formed within me. Then
So that was the first scripture. The second scripture.
that prayer is there in the white book. Okay, what you get?
Yes, exactly.
I have the mind of God and the wisdom of God is formed within me. Therefore, through the wisdom of God, maths is my favorite subject. Science is my favorite subject. Whatever is difficult, turn it around and say it is my favorite subject. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So moving on, my next phase of life turned out to
The next
be for,
assignment is to get your
yeah,
hand.
to get my hand. So my hand, because everybody are on Google, everybody are using internet, you can just Google it, brachial plexus. Okay. You will see what exactly is brachial plexus. So you will see a person with brachial plexus. You can find YouTube videos. They cannot even lift their hand even to a 10 degree angle. Where the hand is just in next to you, you can't even lift your hand because it's completely injured. Your nerves are completely damaged.
What
That
about
is where my
your
situation.
fingers? Do the fingers move?
Yeah. So there were two different types of nerves. My interior nerve were not damaged. So the fingers were fine. But from my shoulder to my elbow, everything like biceps, triceps, deltoid, all these muscles, forearms, everything were damaged. The nerves which hold these muscles were damaged.
So you mean to say from the shoulder to the elbow, no life? From the elbow to the finger, the fingers are moving.
Yes. So there are different nerves that take care of the
This one,
fingers.
Marina is quick. Please read that from the chat. Marina, read it. Those words are too big for me.
The brachial plexus is a network of intertwined nerves that control movement and sensation in the arm and hand. A traumatic brachial plexus injury involves sudden damage to these nerves and may cause weakness, loss of feeling, or loss of movement in the shoulder, arm, or hand.
Okay, go ahead. And nerves cannot be repaired, right?
Yeah, so the nerve grows 0.1 centimeter per day. Given the scientific theory. Sorry?
You said the nerves grow how much?
0.1 centimeter or 0.1, I think it's 1 millimeter. Yeah, it's that
So how much does it grow? Or 1 centimeter will grow in how many years?
way. I don't know. Not calculated it.
Lifetime then. If it is growing point, that means in microns.
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
So now, as he told, there was no feeling in my left hand. So which means I had a hand, but I didn't know that there was a hand because there was complete numbness on my entire left hand. You touch with a pin, you touch with a feather, the same feeling, because there was no feeling. I mean, I don't even know what the object is when they touch on my left hand. So complete numbness was there on my left hand. So now, to come to that point of recovery, I started to dwell. Now, this is something that I learned in the process, that God taught me that I do not have to go and ask God or pray to God because for my healing. I started to seek God first thing. So when I started to seek God because of...
You are giving such a powerful truth. Can you say that again, please?
So I started to pray to God, not for my healing, because God taught me that, son, you are only coming to me because of your healing. But when I started to read the word, Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom. Now, I'm seeking actually my healing. I'm not seeking the kingdom. So when I start to seek the kingdom, my healing should come to me. When this word came to reality, I started to dwell in the word rather than asking God to heal me. Now, when my mind was completely fixed and when I started to dwell in the word and the promises, now what I needed to dwell is correct kind of seeds. The correct type of seeds that I needed to dwell on was already given in the sower and the seed, or the one that I had learned. So I started to take those seeds and started to meditate on it day and night. When there were times that I started to meditate, by the wounds of Jesus, I was completely healed. 1 Peter 2:24, by the wounds of Jesus, I was completely healed. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me from within, Philippians 4:13. So, and I have found favor in the sight of everybody in the sight of the doctors that I visit. So these are the things that I used to started to confess. But eventually, even there was my own self, my flesh used to question me, you are confessing something wrong. You're not able to do physically. There's nothing improvement. There's no improvement. Spiritually, you're telling by the wounds of Jesus, you are healed. Now, there was always a clash. And, these kinds of scriptures that came to my mind, this time I walk by faith and not by sight. So maybe it was foolish for me to just depend on something that I don't see, that I don't feel, that I don't experience. Days have gone by, I'm just confessing it without even feeling anything, there is no movement, there is nothing happening, but still I'm focused on God. You told I have, by the wounds of Jesus, I was healed. By the wounds of Jesus, I was healed. You know, you told God, when you speak to this mountain, and this is the mountain, be uprooted and be planted in the sea, it shall obey you. So I'm speaking to my muscles, I'm speaking to my nerves. So these things I started to confess, declare day in and day out. And there were times where I used to call my friends over the night and I used to tell them, hey buddy, listen, tomorrow morning when you see me, you will see the old Raul, both the arms perfectly fine. You will see a surprise. I used to go, tomorrow morning comes, I used to go meet him and he said, dude, yesterday night you told me something happened. You know, these are the things that I tried by my own self, telling, listen, tomorrow morning this will happen,
faith before the manifestation.
Yeah, so because for me, my understanding was faith, right? I need to speak what I want. So I used to call them and tell them, see, tomorrow morning you will see me fine. Tomorrow morning you will see something different wrong. You know, these were the expectations I set. And every day things started to be the same. I mean, physically, nothing changed. Days went by. I went to the doctors for physiotherapy. It was recommended for me. So when I went to the doctors, I used to tell him, doctor, this hand, there is tinkling pain, or there is tinkling, movement in this hand. And he started to tell me, there is recovery happening inside. Now, these are small little things that I took in my mind. I was like, listen, Devin, listen, arm, you are just doing whatever I'm confessing. You are just falling into places where you need to fall. So I used to stand in front of a mirror and talk to myself and tell my left arm.
Slowly. I don't want you to miss this. This is the master key. I want you to go word by word by word. Because this master key is not only about your physical healing of your hand, it is a healing in your marriage, it is a healing in your finances, it is healing in every area. Please follow the system. Please And Rol, I want you to go as slow as you can. I'll keep stopping you. Yes, I want every juice out. But there are people who are in depression. There are people who are in sorrow. There are people who are in pain. This is the master key. Don't miss it. Yes, go ahead. Slowly.
So James 1:23 says that the Bible is a spiritual mirror. Just the way we look at the mirror every day and clear anything on our face if we find, in the same way, Bible is a spiritual mirror which says how you need to be reflected when you see the Bible. When I had this understanding, I stood in front of the mirror and I had a lot of testimonies from Brother Johnson, which he had done before. So I had applied it. I stood in front of the mirror and I started to speak to myself, speak to directly to my left hand. I used to look at my left hand in the mirror and I used to tell my left hand, hey, listen, hey, Johan, listen to me. You see my right hand? I'm just lifting my right hand. You see what my right hand can do? Elbow flexion. You see what it can do? I can turn, I can lift, I can do this. The same way, you're going to do this. You're going to lift my hand. Ah, yeah, come on, yeah. Believe me, foolishness is just foolishness because my left hand was just there down. I was not able to lift it up. And I used to tell, okay, come on, yes, here you come. Yes, here you go. Okay, fine, now you come up. Okay, fine, now do the next movement.
Pause. Let's go that again. You looked into the mirror and you are not looking at your right hand with your eyes. You're looking at the reflection in the mirror and talking to that reflection in the mirror, right?
Yeah.
And you're saying, left hand, I want you to look at what the right hand is doing. And you lifted your right hand, moved it around, and you now spoke to the left hand in the mirror and said, left hand, did you see how everything, I don't know the names of what you said, they are all functioning correctly.
Yes.
You are created to do the same.
Yes.
So I'm talking to you. Just as the right hand is performing, I want you to do the same.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. And now you said to your left hand, move in the name of Jesus. And now the reflection shows no movement, but your faith is saying, that's good. That's good. Yes, go a little more up. Still higher. Yes. Still higher. Good. Now slowly come down. Come down. Come down. 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 Now when you are saying these words with your natural eyes and with your feelings, the symptoms, the hand has got no life at all and it did not move even a micron. Agreed?
Yes.
But you are saying, well done, left hand. I love you. Now, wasn't that the biggest lie?
No. As I told you,
I know you're crying. I can understand what the Lord has done, brother. Only a person knows when his hand is dead. And at the age of 21, his whole life is gone. Because the dead hand is going to speak to him day and night, all the negative things. And now you are talking to your left hand, and left hand is not moving. And you are continuing to say that because you are speaking your faith and not your facts. Listen, my friend, all those who are listening. God has given to man a very powerful gift. If Rol has heard the testimonies before his accident, though every testimony, there is a key. God has given to man a powerful gift called imagination. When the person uses his imagination, praise God, he can use that gift, Ephesians 3:20, now to God, who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, far more than you can think, imagine, or ask, by the power of love, by the power, that power is love, that is working within you, that is working within you. So here is a person who is operating in the word of God. He is using his mouth, is using his mind, and talking to the left hand and saying, move. With his eyes, he can see there's not even a micron moving, but he's saying, well done, left hand, you did it. Let's practice it again and again and again. And when the devil must be saying, that's foolishness, he's saying, that's what the scripture says. And if the scripture says that, I will rather live by faith and not by sight. Because God has given us a formula of the spiritual world. In Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 2, he says, write down that vision. Write it plainly on the tablet and look at it. Write it so plainly that you can read it and wait on it. Even if it delays, don't quit. Wait on it. It will surely come to pass. So he has got two witnesses from God, both of them talking about make your own vision, make your own dream, make your own desire, make your own expectation, make your own miracle. God is giving us a freedom to make it. And this son says, God, you said it, I'm making it. And now, because the Bible is a mirror, I'm looking through the spiritual mirror. Even though I'm looking into my physical mirror, and the physical mirror says the hand did not move, the spiritual mirror is saying that God is able to do it if I believe. Yes, go ahead, Raul. How many times did that happen?
It happened for a series of night. I don't remember how long.
So throughout the day, you would do that in your bedroom?
Yeah, only in my bedroom, only personally. But I know when people see, they laugh. So I was always in the bedroom.
The advantage with you was that mom is also a rock. She's also a mighty warrior. Dad also is a mighty warrior. So the whole atmosphere in the house was faith.
Yeah.
And you did not mingle with people outside. Neither did you go for counseling. You got stuck to the word of God, and the word of God became your counselor. He became your teacher. He became your guide. He began to explain to you what has to be done.
Yes.
So in a day, you would keep on repeating this in front of the mirror.
Yes.
Over and over again, and you did not see one movement.
No.
So was it not discouraging, because now when you're talking and you can't see even a slightest movement?
It was very discouraging physically, but yeah, by faith. So I had to change my mind. So this was a process of renewing my mind. So I should tell myself, Raul, it is not what you see, it is what you believe. Raul, it is not what you see, it is what you believe. So when these things became real to me, I stopped thinking about my hand lifting physically or not. I didn't even care whether my hand was lifted physically, I could see it or not. I used to tell myself, okay, fine, I'm lifting my left hand, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm doing my daily activities in my left hand. So when I started to believe, or my mind was completely out of focus from my physical being to what I really wanted in my spirit that I was praying for, things, you know, eventually what happened over a period of time, God put together 2 months. I didn't even realize that I was able to lift my hand. I didn't even realize when was the first time I lifted my hand.
You mean to say, as you are practicing every day, you did not even realize that your left hand was moving, and you did not even realize?
No, yeah, exactly right.
So you were so much engrossed in your speaking and imagination that you did not know whether the imagination and reality are different.
Yeah, so I didn't even realize that my left arm was already moving. Because when I started...
How much did it move in the beginning?
it moved, say, 20% or 20 degrees, okay, from a 90 degree or from directly 0 degree, 20 degree up. So when I questioned myself, telling me, hey, my left hand is moving, it was already moving 180 degree. So which means that phase of 20 degree to 180 degree, I didn't even know when did that happen in this process.
Hold on. You know what is coming to my mind? Son, listen, what's coming to my mind? You remember Elijah fighting the battle?
Yeah. With
the prophets. Correct?
Yeah.
Ahab's wife, what is her name? Jezebel.
Yeah.
She threatened him that I'm going to kill you. As the prophets were killed. Elijah ran for his life and went and hid in the cave. Yeah. And then he began to pray. And the prayer was, Lord, when your people repent and come back to you, you will forgive them and open the windows of heaven and it will rain. So he stuck on the scripture. At the same time, he's telling the servant, go and see for the clouds. Okay. Six times nothing happened. But the seventh time, there was a cloud as small as a palm of the hand. But you were so engrossed that it has already been completed that you did not even realize when it went to 180.
Yeah.
And when Ahab saw the cloud as small as a palm of a hand, he told the servant, go and tell King Ahab it's going to rain and tell him if he can get into the palace. And the rain came after 3 years and 6 months, and it was so heavy that the chariot wheels got jammed on the ground and Ahab could not enter the palace. Yes. How many times has God shown us the cloud of a palm of a hand? How many times God has shown us his mighty healing? But the problem is, instead of having gratitude towards God that he showed us the small opening and releasing your faith and confidence for the bigger one, the devil says, hey, it is just a small one. And we get into grumbling, murmuring. You know, when the husband is drinking every day, the day he doesn't drink and you start praising God, God, I can see the breakthrough has come, praise God. And he drinks again. Even if he drinks again, you keep praising with gratitude, bang, it's going to rain a complete deliverance right from the root and the husband is set free. So tell us, go back to the mirror again, please. I don't want you to come out from that. Go back to the mirror.
Yeah.
You did it for how many months?
So in this process, around 2 months. I don't know the specific dates.
Okay.
But around 2 months.
Okay.
So it was after 2 months I realized that my hand was completely.
So you repeated moving. That you repeated that exercise so many times that you were not even bothered about the symptom.
Yeah. Yeah.
So automatically your physical eyesight became like blind, and your spiritual eyes became brighter to see your left hand is already moving.
Yeah. So this is where I told you that God taught me in this process not to seek your healing. But when your focus more is dependent on God and his love and what he has promised, automatically things will come. So this is the process where I learned that it was not because of my healing that I need to seek God for.
Okay. Now, if I tell you, if others were there in this situation, would anybody take this as a medicine for a healing of the hand? Come on the chat. Come on, how many people in the world do you find who will take this? I'm not talking about the spiritual part. I'm talking about the natural part. Listen, all of you are saying, yes, come on. I'm talking about the physical happening in your life. Would you take that? And those who have put yes, my question to you is, those who have put yes, do you have issues in your life? Hello, do you have issues in your life? Yes. In those issues, why are you so much worried and why are you still asking for prayers that when you can believe for this big miracle of this brother and you can say yes, 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 then how come you are depressed in your area? Why don't you use that area where your son, your daughter, your husband, your finances, whatever is going through you, are you willing to see yourself in a mirror that your child is holding the Bible and preaching the word of God? Or are you still seeing what your son is doing, what your daughter is doing, what your husband is doing, what your wife is doing? Don't give oral yes answers. If you are practicing the same, then show me the evidence of that you believed it, you did it, and you came with evidence. Do you know Rawl, coming back? A person can give an oral exam very good. Believe me, it's very easy to give an oral exam. Yes, I believe that. Then how come in your area where you are sinking right now, why have you not been able to come out? Why is it that the devil keeps bashing you in that area that he gets you into sorrow and pain? Somebody wrote it right. Brother, we are practicing and things are changed and they have to change. Good. That's a good answer. The moment you're saying I'm perfect, then why are you sitting here? The moment you say, Lord, teach me like this, brother. I'm going through a situation where my son has gone on the wrong side. And every time I get bashed up when I think about my son. I've been praying, Lord, but instead of things improving, things are going even more negative than before. I can understand. Lord, teach me now to be like him. Speak it so many times looking into the mirror that I forget the symptoms of my son and I start loving him as if he has already changed. And even if he has not changed, teach me to love him and accept him the way he is, the way you accept me. And you know when I began to learn this formula, I made the same formula for the auditorium in Goa. Now, when you are going on a trip of building an auditorium where you know and you know you're not capable of, you don't have the resources, you don't know which people, you know nothing. And one rule till the end, I will not go and beg and borrow. From where will the resources come? I don't know. Who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? I don't know. But I know one thing. I will look into the mirror. And in those days, my laptop was my mirror. I'd put the model of that auditorium. I would look at it, spend hours with that picture and talk to God. God, this is my pregnancy. And I can see, Lord, the foundation has been laid. I can see, Lord, this has been done. That has been done. And I can also see, Lord, the checks have come and the payment has been done. God is my witness. The whole thing got completed without me sweating. It happened in a supernatural way. Different people came whom I've never seen before, whom I don't know, nothing at all. These people came from different directions with their resources, with their gifts, with their talents, with their expertise, and they all came and built the house of God. And this house of God was and is built on the foundation of faith. That is why I enjoy this principle. That is why to move on a mission is a mission of applying the principles in the Bible. when you are operating on these principles, believe me, your life cannot be natural. Every day, where you, wherever you go, in whichever direction you go, signs and wonders have to follow. It is impossible. It is impossible that your life is still natural. If you are saying I am traveling in a flight, I know you will reach Dubai. But you are saying I'm flying on a flight, but you never boarded the flight. Now, will you reach Dubai from India? Wrong?
Yes, Papa.
Can a person reach India without a flight?
No.
He can get on the ship, but on the ship also it will take a number of days or weeks.
Yeah.
So when a person is saying, I have been practicing this formula, show me the evidence of how this formula has affected the kingdom of God. What we are studying is, please, this formula is available to everybody. God doesn't look whether you are a pastor, whether you are a priest, whether you are nun, whether you are religious, whether you are this. It works even for a drunkard. It works even for a drug addict. When a person repents and comes to the Lord, he gets born again. God doesn't look at your past. Now, Rol.
Yes, Papa.
That was the first time you had taken drink in your life.
Yeah.
When you were taking that drink, did you ever think that tonight this is going to happen to you because of this?
No.
If you had to know, would you take it?
No, I wouldn't have.
After that, have you taken it?
No.
When you stay on the word puts a boundary that the devil cannot touch you. He can come and do all kinds of nonsense against you, but your faith has the power to make him flee from you. I want you to repeat that again, please. Starting with the mirror. Go ahead.
Okay. So I used to stand in front of the mirror.
Okay.
And look at my left hand in the mirror and tell to my left hand, listen, left hand, look at my right hand. See the way he's functioning. See the muscles, see the nerves, see the flexion, see the abduction, see whatever I'm able to turn, my wrist, my elbow, every movement that I'm able to do, you are doing it. Listen, you have no other option but to believe, but to do whatever I tell you to do in the name of Jesus. And here you go. You're lifting. You are okay. I'm able to see that you're coming up. You're flexing your elbows. My muscles have come back, and I'm able to see that I can compare both my right biceps, left biceps are similar to each other. My forearms, the muscles are similar. My biceps muscles are similar. So when you have to listen to me. So when I started doing it, maybe physically it was not visible for me. But yes, by faith, I used to tell that my left hand, I'm just raising it above my shoulder and I'm able to do my movements. So these things is what I started to believe and see it before it getting manifested in my natural life. And this happened.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
And this happened like as a process. It was just not an overnight. But in this process, as I had told you, I used to call people and I used to tell them, listen, tomorrow you will see a different role. Listen, this is what happens. So I tried to give myself the timing as to by tomorrow it will happen. The timing in my mind was set by me. Now, when that means that I am not depending on God's own timing. So again, that was another lesson for me. So when I started to do that, I knew that it was working on. Now, whenever I promised somebody and when they started questioning me, asking me, what was special about today? Why did you call me yesterday night? What did you tell me? So I didn't have an answer to give them. But yes, all these things actually made me go low. However, on the other side, because my mind was fixed on the word, I did not give up in this process. So this process took a ups and downs from both the sides, but because I was stayed focused or I committed to what I believed for, I used to do the same way again and again.
Praise God. Now somebody is asking you in the chat, it was your test roll from the Lord to bring your soul to his kingdom. You did not even know his plans. Praise God. Now my question to you is, according to this person, was it God's test for you to go through the accident and bring you to the kingdom of God?
No.
Roll, what do you think?
No, not at all.
Then what was this test?
Again, as I told you, it was from my own mistake that I had fallen into a pit. It was from my own mistake, my own decisions that made me fall into the pit.
So because you took a drink, Satan took advantage, yes, and he decided to kill you.
Yes.
But God in his mercy saved you.
Yes.
So did God cause an accident for you?
No.
Or was it your own seed that caused an accident?
My own seed.
Now, was God a savior in that test?
Yes.
Did God give up on you because you made a mistake?
No, not at all.
Was he and is he the same good shepherd who left the 99 and came after you, Saul?
Yes.
So was it God's plan for you to go through all this?
No, it was not God's plan. To...
Good. Because whenever anything wrong happens, we are so quick to say it was God. You know what the Bible, what Jesus said? It is the thief who comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Exactly right.
It was the thief who used his friends.
Exactly right.
Get him. It was the thief who got that friend wake up in the middle of the night and said, "Let's go for coffee for 200 kilometers for a coffee." Foolish. It was the thief. And even though the thief trapped him, God saved him. And do you know why you got saved, Prabha? Hello?
Yes, Papa.
Do you know why you got saved? I'll give you proof from the Bible. Do you know why you got saved?
2 Corinthians 1:4.
I will tell you why you got saved. All this time when you were in the car, learning the sower and the seed, the seeds were deposited in your spiritual bank account. And when the accident took place, you were not in your senses to call for the angels to protect you. God has put his angels to protect you.
Yeah.
And the angels hearken to God's spoken word. So exactly. What you were speaking when everything was fine, there was a deposit in your spiritual bank account. The angels moved, taking the deposit from your bank account and got into action, even though you did not have the time to open your mouth.
Praise God.
What happens to many people is they have not even opened their spiritual account because they've never opened the Bible.
Yeah. Yes.
So when somebody says that, you know, it was God's plan to save your soul, God will never use the tools of hell to bring you to the knowledge of truth. Because if he does that, he has broken his own law. Because the Bible says only the goodness of God, good things come from God. So where did these negative things come? It came from the devil. What was his plan? Kill you. What was God's plan? In the midst of that, to show you, when you turn to him, his glory. That there is nothing impossible to my God. Medical science may say that nerve which is gone forever. And God is saying, I will prove to you wrong. I will prove to them wrong. Because you, my son, are focused on me. You, my son, is using the spiritual law. Now using that spiritual law, I will even change the natural law for you.
Amazing. Thank you, Lord.
I'll tell you the bottom line.
Yeah, Papa.
That day when you took a drink, I'm not condemning you, okay? Baba?
Yes, Papa. Yes,
we all make mistakes. Okay? Yeah. I'm talking in general. What you did on that day cost you your whole future.
Yeah.
Now, in this, it caused an accident.
Yeah.
But there are many things which we do and the manifestation has not yet come. But it is growing in the spiritual realm. One day to manifest. Because the principle works on sowing and reaping. Agreed?
Yes.
So when you got that harvest, you stopped doing what you can do. You did not go for drink, but you stopped doing what you can do is you stopped anxiety. You stopped fear. You stopped negative speaking. You stopped going to the wrong counseling. You stopped mingling with people. And you started doing what others don't do. Sitting with the word day and night and looking into the mirror, the spiritual mirror, and talking. Now tell me, how many of us do you find will look into the spiritual mirror where Paul is saying this slight affliction and then he's talking about his affliction. He was whipped, he was shipwrecked, he was stoned to death, and he got up, all those things. Now how many of us will look into that mirror and say, Lord, if this is what Paul went through, what I'm going through is nothing. And if Paul could rejoice in all this, Lord, I am going to imagine now that this same power which you gave to Paul is inside of me. From now on, I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to thank God. And this thing is not going to have any effect on me because it had no effect on Paul. And therefore, I'm victorious. How many people do you think will do that? If you could do that, looking into the mirror and speak to your nerves and your muscles, and in 2 months doing it every day, the dead came back alive. Agreed?
Yes, Papa.
So a person is in depression, is looking at Paul, is looking at Peter, is looking at those people who went through persecution and opposition, and is saying, Lord, the same Holy Spirit helped you, Jesus, when you were crucified. The same Holy Spirit helped David, helped Daniel, helped the three friends. Now, I have the same Holy Spirit. So from now on, I'm going to use my imagination that this, what I'm going through compared to them, is nothing. So I am going to draw the same power from the Holy Spirit that I am just as waterproof, pain proof, negative emotion proof. And when does this happen? When I spend my time in doing what others don't do. Do you know who is a champ? A champ is that person who has fallen down. Everybody falls. But a champ is that person who gets up and starts doing what others don't want to do. He does the same thing over and over and over and over. Even though he cannot see the result, he's still doing it. Because his imagination is that cup. And he keeps on doing it so many times, repeatedly, 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 that every day he's making a slight progress. And the day he goes and takes that cup, everybody's praising him and saying, wow, how wonderful it is. But does anybody think how much of labor he did to get himself to that position? If that much labor is there in the physical, my friend, that same kind of labor is there in the spiritual. Stop doing what everybody is doing and start doing what others are not doing. Stop doing what others start speaking. Don't do that. And start doing what the heroes in the Bible did. Look at that mirror and say, it happened to you. It happened to you. I'm going to do what they did. I'm going to do what they did. Therefore, from now on, if you see Virajani's testimony, what was she doing? She saw in the mirror 1 Corinthians 13:4 onwards, and she kept saying, Niranjani, you are full of love. You are full of patience. You are full of endurance. You are full of kindness. You are full of self-control. Now, what was she doing? Speaking to herself to do what the mirror says. That's absolutely right, Christina. A champion is the one who doesn't sit crying. He gets up and never gives up. And he says, I'm coming back. But before I come back, I'm going to train myself in front of the mirror. And the mirror is the Bible. There is something called as self-talking. You know what's self-talking? Grumbling, murmuring, and complaining. That self-talking is a gift from God. Now, what Viranjani was doing, she took the same self-talking and started talking to herself. When she was depressed, she was talking to herself how miserable she is, how this is, how that is. Look at this one, that one, that one, that one. Now she changed. She took the mirror called the Word of God and kept saying to herself, Viranjani is full of love, full of patience. Now she changed the vision. I and my husband are doing the ministry together. My children are living a life of integrity. They are doing this, they are doing that. Now what is she doing? She is doing what Raul is doing, what Raul did. And that's how Raul could get the dead nerves alive. You know, when somebody is putting on the this thing, my wife say, I'm mad when I talk to myself. You know what you're doing? You're putting your wife to shame. Anybody who's putting on the chat, put the good things about a person. Because when you make public, you have planted a bad seed. A person who loves, the Bible says, a person who loves does not speak the negative thing of that person. Why? Because he covers it up. That, how do you know? Okay, I'll give you an example. How do you know you love somebody? When your child does anything bad in school, do you go on the rooftop and tell everybody what your son has done? No. But the next door neighbor whom you hate a lot and his son did something wrong in the school, do you spread it all around? Why? Because you hate him. When you love somebody, you become a shock observer. You become a hurt observer. You take all that, collect it and give it to Jesus. You don't keep it with yourself. And because you don't have it, it can't come out of your mouth. It is coming out of your mouth because you still have it. Yeah, Rol, go ahead.
Yes,
I'm
Papa.
Sorry, I took you there. Because that, if that formula is practiced, I'll tell you, anybody can overcome anything in life.
Yeah. Yes, Papa.
Go ahead, Rol.
So, when my hand started to do whatever I started to believe for, and it the supernatural became, or the spiritual became manifested naturally, I was able to do my daily activities, started to play football.
Okay.
Do my...
I know that. I'll call you again, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because at 1 o'clock, we have to give to the Sydney people because it's their hour.
Okay.
I don't want to stop them. Okay. Now I want you to tell me fast forward. I'll call you again for other things. I'm not going to spare you. Anyway, it's a lockdown. I can get you. Okay. Now I want you to take me to that place when you decided to go and meet the doctor. After this thing has happened.
After this thing has happened, we went a couple of times to the doctor. Like before the recovery, you mean to say? When I was wearing a sling?
According to the doctor, this cannot
okay.
be.
Yeah. So
okay.
after which...
How did you enter the clinic? And how did he see you? And how did he encourage you? And then you said, doctor, I want to show you something. I want you to give me that description. Come on.
So... When I met with this accident, this doctor who treated me, he informed my parents, it seems that this condition is, you know, it's declared as paralysis, where the left hand will never come back again, and he has already treated some of the people, by which he is declaring that this will be the condition all of his life. So once this happened, and when I regained my memory and I had to meet him again, when we went to the doctor, he was amazed to see the movements that I could do. He was amazed to see the things.
Did you go to the clinic as if it is not working, sat down there, heard all that the doctor said, and then got up? If I was you, I would have done that. Believe me, I would have done that. I would have done like this and gone there and sat down. And the poor fellow is encouraging me with all medical science. And then it was my turn to say, you know, doctor, I believe what you're saying, but that's a fact. What I believe is in Jesus. And then he would have some argument, and then this, and then I would say to him, you know, doctor, I want to show you something. And I would show you what has happened.
Yeah, but I didn't do that. Rather, I went to the doctor.
You're a good person, not like me. Not me.
Yeah. So when I went, and when he saw me, as soon as I entered itself, he saw me. We told him, remember, doctor, you had treated me. My mom told him that, remember, you had treated my son, and all these things had happened. So he was amazed to see, how come you are able to do things? It's really the way that you have recovered. I have never seen anybody recovering in such a short span of time, and the amount of movements and the recovery that you are showing, the improvements that you are showing, I've never seen this happening. So for me, I knew what is happening. I mean, I knew whose work is this. So I didn't have to, I really did not argue with him. All I told, that's okay, doctor. So praise God for what has happened. And we just moved on. So I did not argue with him for sure or anything of this.
Okay. Now we want to see you showing us your hand.
One minute. Let me switch on the...
Wait, brother, we'll give you a request.
Yeah, but I have to give permission from my iPhone, just a minute. Because iPhone has applications that has to...
Isn't that a beautiful testimony?
Yeah, Papa.
A person who fought his battle, applying the principles.
Yeah.
And the best part is, I don't remember him calling me and saying, Papa, he calls me Papa, saying to me, you know, please.
Pray for me.
But using the recorded message, and applying them in his day-to-day life. Okay, Raul raised his hand. Just see what he's saying.
Yeah, you can. I think I can start my video. You can see me.
Yes. Okay. Raul, we need one more thing from you. Can you turn your mobile this way?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Show me your right hand and then show me your left hand. We want to see.
So this is my... Okay, I'll just keep it far so you will know. 1 minute.
Oh, you are in Bangalore? Where are you? In Abu Dhabi?
Okay. So I'm not wearing my headphones. Now, this is my right hand where I can lift it. And this is my left hand where I can do it. So the same.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it's
so
okay.
So the same thing that I can do. This is the muscle that I can show you that is grown. You see that muscles, which was completely dead. You see that muscle? The same way as my right hand.
The right hand is too close.
Sorry?
The right hand is too close.
Sorry?
I said the right hand was too close.
Okay.
Let me show you the right hand. Okay.
Yes.
This is my right. Okay. And this is my left hand.
Yes, same, same. So you're doing exercise as well.
Yes. So, this is something that I learned. If you remember, just wanted to share something that God has taught me recently. 1 minute. So I was asking God, you told that by the wounds of Jesus, I was healed. So then why do I need to do exercise? Like, I can just sit there and just, confess scriptures, by the wounds of Jesus, I was healed, and it should work fine. So why again should I do exercise? And God shared with me something beautiful. He told, you had taught us about grace, and you had taught us about how when a person gets only 34 marks out of 100 and he needs only one mark, he would be given a grace mark, which means 34 marks he had tried from his end. Why doesn't a person who has got 10 marks get a grace mark and clear it? So there is something from my part that you need to do, and there's something from God's part that he needs to do. So yes, you are trying, but you are unqualified from your end, and then I make you qualified. So that is where I understood that it is an effort of both of them, me as well as God, together will make the work done, will make the job done.
So that's when you started doing the exercise. Do you know what I learned just now, Baba? What you're saying is true. When a student gets only 5 marks, the teacher doesn't give him the grace mark and qualifies to the next class. It is only, at least he should get 25 to get the 10 marks grace. But if he's got 15, he repeats the class.
Yes.
So if I don't pick up the scriptures at all, and I'm saying, Lord, now give me the grace mark and qualify me to the next class. Oh, fantastic. I learned it. Thank you.
Okay. So yeah, this is what God has been teaching me. And I have another thing that God taught me in this process was, he told me, Raul, see, you need to tell people, or whenever I share my testimony, I tell them that don't go, like somebody told, right? It was God who brought, the test you had to pass. God gave you this test. So God told me, Raul, it is not about the test that you're asking me the strength to pass. Remember, I came to give you life and life in abundance, which means you are completely healed. You have everything that you need in your life. But it is the enemy who has already stolen your health. It is the enemy who has already stolen your blessing. So when you pray, don't pray for something that you need from me. Pray or ask the enemy or tell the enemy to give something that it belongs to you. You know, there are two different ways that I can pray. I can ask God to give me the health, or I can tell the enemy to give what he's stealing from me, because I believe God has already given me.
Okay, I'll give you that. I'll give you that, okay? We know that the enemy has stolen your health, right? Put Proverbs 6:31. Fantastic. Sweetheart, amazing teaching. Proverbs 6:31.
But if he be found,
that he is the thief, okay?
Yes.
Hello, that he is the thief. Yes.
But if he be found, he shall restore sevenfold. He shall give all the substance of his house.
So when the thief has stolen from you, and you attack the thief, and you make a demand, okay? When you have captivated the thief by overcoming your temptations and all that, he has to pay you back 7 times of all that he has stolen from you. That's the law.
Yes.
And that comes from his kingdom. What all good things he has stolen from you, he has to repay back 7 times.
Yes.
Did you know this 7 times?
Yes, Papa.
Sorry?
Yes, Papa, 7 times, yes.
You had heard it before?
Yes, Papa.
Good, good, good.
Amazing. So when God taught me this, my entire, the intention or the way I started to pray even before I start my prayer, I knew there is a way to pray. Because what God is asking is something different than what we are trying to pray and telling why my prayers are not answered. Now, this made more sense for me that I cannot, you know, the enemy does not give you anything. He has no ability to give you anything. That is the very reason God says only I can give you. If the enemy, if you have something that is not from God, which means it is not that enemy has given you, which means that enemy has stolen what God has given you. There are two different meanings, you know. If you have something, if you have lack, if you're anxious, if you're angry, or if you have
one minute. Okay, go ahead. Permission granted.
Praise God. So I was telling that if we have financial loss, if you are going through some relationship problem or any struggle in your studies, so all these situations that we are in, which we know is not from God, it is not from God, or we should never think it is from God. We should rather think that what God has already given me, what has He given me? He's given me health, He's given me joy, He's given me victory. If we are not experiencing any of this, then there is no point of Jesus dying for us on the cross. If He has already done and it is declared is finished, which means we have to be victorious, we have to be joyful, we have to be healthy, then why am I not experiencing this? It's because somebody has stolen from you. Somebody is still stealing from us. And when I have that mindset of telling God, God, I thank you for blessing me with whatever you have done on the cross, but there is this person who is trying to steal everything from me, and I need to divert my prayers in such a way, or make my prayers in such a way that I need to tell the enemy to stop stealing from me, rather than telling God, why am I in this situation? Because God did not give you the situation, and the enemy also did not give you the situation. The enemy is stealing something that God has already given us.
Okay, I'll put it as an example.
Yes, Papa.
So that what you are saying, people will understand. Okay. You went, not you, Mr. A went to church.
Okay.
Okay. On his way back, he meets people, he has spoken to everybody, and he's joyful, and he's coming back, and he's opening the lock. He enters the house, okay, and he goes around. And when he reaches the bedroom, his cupboard is open. So at once he runs to the cupboard because he remembers he had locked the cupboard. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
The cupboard is open. He goes straight to the locker in the cupboard and he finds the locker also is open and all the jewels are stolen.
Okay.
Everything is stolen.
Stolen.
He begins to search the whole house. The windows are closed as he left. Nothing is disturbed in the house. But he cannot see any person. Now he is sitting and wondering, how come the jewels and everything can disappear? There has to be somebody who has stolen it. Is that right?
Yes.
So when your health is missing, does that mean the thief has stolen?
Yes.
When your finances are missing, does that mean the thief has stolen?
Yes.
So that day, he closes. And that day was his salary. Okay, he puts the money in the same locker and goes to work the next day. When he comes in the evening, again the money is stolen. That means somebody has got a key that is opening the lock, walking in, not touching anything, opening the locker and taking.
Yes, yes.
So he says, let's check the third time. He goes and borrows some money and puts this money again in the locker. And again he goes in the morning, comes back in the evening. Again that money is gone. So does the thief have access? He has got the key. He comes to the house and takes it and takes it and takes it. Now does he need to chain the lock?
Yes.
What obviously. If he's not changing the lock?
The money will be stolen again.
So when he changes the lock, now the thief comes to put the key. The lock is not opening.
Yeah.
In the same way, when a person is living a life of disobedience, he has given the thief the chance to steal. When he's living a life of fear and anxiety, he has given the chance to steal. When he gets the word of God in him and renews his mind, he has chained the lock.
Exactly.
The moment he has chained the lock and now the devil is putting the key, it's not opening. And as the person is getting stronger and stronger in the world, he begins to realize the authority that he has. He picks up the phone and talks to the devil and says, I know who you are and what all things you have stolen. Before I call my big brother, his name is Jesus, okay? Let's make a deal. All those things that you have stolen, according to the word of God, you have to repay me 7 times.
Yeah.
So when you make that call and you say, I am not settling for 1 time, 7 times in the name of Jesus, everything he has to repay because it's a spiritual law. Yeah. But what if you are not strong and you call him and you have not changed your lock? Now, will he bash you again?
Yes, he will obviously bash me.
All this time he was stealing your money. Now he has started, now he has bashed you and you are in the hospital.
Yeah.
Now, in this crisis, you learned all these good things and you are now beginning to understand the truth. Now you are saying, no matter what happens, I am not allowing the thief to enter my house, my family, my spouse, my children. I keep a check on everybody and the word of God is my fortress.
Exactly right.
So go ahead and make a prayer because we have to give the Sydney people.
Okay.
The classroom belongs to them now.
Yeah, no problem. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for this time, for this time of fellowship, O God. Thank you, Lord, for all these people of whom you have brought together. And it is you, O God, who has called us and who has chosen us to be a true warrior in your kingdom, O God. Lord, you know everything that each one of them are going through right now, O God. Their situations, their problems. And as you have led me to share whatever you have taught me, O God, that these seeds that I have sown, O God, is, I believe that they have been sown in a fertile ground, O God. That as they apply these seeds and water these seeds, practicing them day and night, O God, and meditating on them, believing and keeping an imagination just the way you help me to keep the imagination of what your promises say, O God. As these people keep the imaginations of what they're believing it for, O God, and this vision will come to pass. It will not be tarried, O God, but you will bring it to completion. Because the word says that you are the author and the finisher of our faith, O God. Lord, it is you who will do miraculous things that we believe in, O God. Lord, I thank you that in this process, O God, that you have taught me so many things, O God, to just make me like Christ in the same way, O God. As every one of us go through different process, different exams or different opportunities, obstacles in our lives that we are going through, O God, these obstacles will not only, we will not only go through it, but also grow through it, O God, come out victorious in every area and be more like Jesus, O God, and be more like Jesus to be a blessing, not only for others in our family, but also to the ends of the world, O God. I thank you, Father God, for all these things. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
So before we close down, Raul, according to what happened, can one act of disobedience cause you your entire life?
For sure.
So one act of disobedience can be so costly that you could lie down on the bed for your
forever. Yes.
So that one act of disobedience has stolen your whole future.
Yes.
Now when everything was stolen, your act of obedience brought you closer and closer to your miracle. Exactly. And you began to do things that you never knew before.
Yes.
So that crisis that was caused by your own mistake, and the devil said, I have finished him. God said, no. Your response role made the result of that crisis change in such a way that you came out growing stronger, bigger, and more deeper with the Lord.
Yes.
God bless you. Are you free in the afternoon? Or you got me?
Yes, Papa, I'm free. Like what time?
Whenever we are, you please let me know. I'll call you again. There's more juice to be removed.
Okay, Papa, sure.
So God bless you and thank you so much.
God bless you, Papa. Bye-bye.
Praise God. Father, we thank you, we praise you for all that we learn every day, Lord. And it is such a great joy when you pick up the simple, even though we have made mistakes, you don't abandon us. In our mistakes, you forgive us. And from there, you take us on a journey, teaching us all that we had learned as a theory. You teach us as practical examination, each day talking to you by practicing and practicing and practicing, so that those words which were just words have become flesh in us. And when they become flesh, we not only have victory over Satan's plan, but we become a warrior to teach others in their battles how to get the victory. Thank you, Father, for showing us the process, that instead of being beggars, we are believers. We believe your word, and your word itself is Jesus. Lord Jesus, we always say, Jesus fights my battle. Now we understand, Jesus, it is your word, it is your spirit. When we believe that it is you, your word and your spirit have created this universe, and your word and your spirit recreates us and makes us more and more like you. We thank you, we praise you. And this testimony which has been given, Lord, let this testimony touch the hearts, help people to renew their mind, teach people to practice. And the biggest secret, he said, if I got 10 marks, I won't get the grace. I have to practice from my side of mixing my faith. And when I mix my faith to that grace, then only there is manifestation of glory. All that you have finished on the cross is grace. All that I believe and move into action in my agreement is my faith. And wherever grace and faith come together, there is manifestation. What you said in the mirror and what you promised in the mirror is grace. And I thank you for this son who did not look what the world would look at, continued to do things in his bedroom for 2 months from morning till night, practicing it over and over and over again. There were times of discouragement, but did not quit, but continued to look into the mirror called grace and exercised his faith till a day came when everything was manifested. And today, with boldness and with gratitude, he's showing his arms to show this is what the Lord has done. And what the Lord has done is only glory and glory and glory. We bow down to your Lordship, Almighty God, and forgive us for the times that we do not follow your system, but we follow the system of fear and we destroy ourselves. From now on, we make this decision to walk in your love and to walk in faith and not by sight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, let's take, for example, Rolf.
Yeah.
He is doing something at home in his bedroom.
Yes.
Okay. He is doing something looking into the mirror.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
So is he following the instruction in the mirror?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
So when Moses saw his burning bush and he got up from the seat and went to look at the burning bush. Can you put that? We'll study this. This is very important.
Okay.
Exodus chapter 3 verse 1, 2 and 3. Come on, quickly. Put it on the chat. Jude, first of all, you are kept out. Okay. And now when you are kept in, all responsibility is given to you with all those hurts and everything. And now you are back on the chat. And look, Marina was supposed to help us. She's come. Okay.
Rescuer.
Before I could talk about Marina, she quickly brought it. Okay. Okay.
You want it to be read? I was wondering why is Brother June not putting live.
Okay. let's come back because let's not miss the beautiful secret for your miracle. This is a very powerful secret. Okay, look at this. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. Now Moses is who? He should have been a prince in Egypt. He's looking after the sheep, the cattle, because of his one mistake. Okay. Now the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. How many years? 40 years.
40 years.
Imagine the hurt from the prince to the shepherd boy for 40 years. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And Moses looked. And Moses looked.
Looked.
Moses
looked.
Looked.
Say that again.
Looked.
Moses looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Now, burning fire, we know in Australia how it burns every year. So, burning in a desert where there is so much of heat is very common. But what was uncommon was he saw that this bush had fire, but the bush was not getting burned, but the fire was burning. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not
burning.
Okay, the fourth verse. And when the Lord saw, I want you to read the third verse and the fourth verse. Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. Roll is saying, I read in the Bible that when I look into the mirror and imitate what the mirror says, God looks at me when I'm looking into the mirror. Agreed?
Yes.
So when nobody is seeing him, at that time, Raul is practicing in his home the burning bush. He is speaking the burning bush. He is looking into the mirror, the burning bush. Everything that is practicing is the
burning bush.
And when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called him out. So is the Lord seeing Raul doing something in his bedroom?
Yes.
And what he's doing in his bedroom, can God see him that he's following the principles in the Bible?
Yes.
Now when God is seeing that this fellow is doing every day what is in the mirror called the Bible, what is happening? Raul is not understanding, might be at that time, but today God wants to tell us, when God sees what you are doing in the secret of the secret, your future is changing in the direction of God. But if that same person in the secret of the secret is doing something that is against the mirror, Satan is seeing what you are doing, because he has been showing you his mirror. And when he sees what you are doing, now he's saying, because you're looking over there, let me go and finish the job from my kingdom.
Amen.
So what is very important is who is seeing you in the secret of the secrets.
Wow.
And whoever is seeing you, your future is changing in that direction. So when his memory is gone and he's saying, because the word of God says, I have the mind of Christ. And he's saying, if I have the mind of Christ, that same mind of Christ gave the professor the mind to write the book. And that same mind is in me. That means his mind, what he has, also is in me. Then I also can do it. So when God sees that this role is talking, looking, imagining, feeling, everything according to what I said, so the system is, the switch is put on, the mute switch of the devil. The devil is put to mute, God is put to speak, so the devil can now make all actions and try to draw the attention, but he still stuck to God's switch for 4 months, and in 4 months gets the distinction.
Amen.
Now let's take the same thing. In the marriage, one is godly, one is ungodly. The ungodly has got God's switch mute, Satan's switch on. And that Satan's switch on, he is coming and giving to his godly spouse all that the devil is talking. Now the spouse is also listening, and she has got two mirrors. One the eye showing the natural mirror, the other one showing the spiritual mirror, that is God. Now might be in front of the husband, she's not saying anything, but she might go to the toilet and over there, she can do all those things. Can the husband see? No. She might put a good screensaver, but inside the heart is bleeding. Can the devil see? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So the devil can see she's meditating on what all that I'm saying. So what is going to be the future? Your future is going to depend who is seeing you in the secret of the secret place. In the midst of your situations, where are you seeing? And what are you thinking? Now, who is seeing you decides your future. Whereas Raul, he began to see the spiritual mirror day and night. God saw it and he said, let me do something supernatural for him, because he just muted the devil and he unmuted me. So it's now my turn to speak. Hallelujah. So my friends, what do I do? Is the Lord can see?
Yes.
The devil can see? And if somebody is saying, I spoke the scriptures 100 times, but I did not get the breakthrough, because God is not speaking, God is not looking at how many times you spoke the scriptures. He's looking at what is the condition of your heart.
Amen.
Did you remember what he said? When I began to speak so much that I did not even bother to look at my hand that is frozen, but I looked at my hand, is already moving, and I did not even realize when it had already started moving 20. And when I saw it moving 20, I was only thinking of 180, and bang, it happened 180, and I did not even know when.
Nice.
So me staying in the depression or me staying in the Lord, is it going to depend on how many times I spoke or what is running in my mind?
Running in my mind.
Who is seeing me in the secret of the secret? Where do we do maximum blunders? In public or in secret?
Secret.
Secret.
And where's the real future locked up?
Secret.
The secret.
And where is the devil going to beat you up?
The secret.
And when God is saying, my son is going to move in my direction, but the son is moving in the opposite direction, what is happening? Satan is saying, you have got connected to me. I will surely serve you with every destruction that you can't even imagine of. Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now, having known the principle by Raul, by having known the principles that he had already heard the testimonies, was he trying to do the same in his life? So was he imitating the testimonies? Why is the person imitating the testimonies? Why is it encouraging you when you hear the testimonies? Because testimonies gives you hope, gives you expectation. You begin to predict the things. You begin to learn the system. And when your expectation has changed, when your prediction has changed, and you're holding on to the promises, those promises are the source which brings those predictions to success. Let me give you an example. When I heard a testimony of a man who wanted an organ, what was the reason he wanted the organ? To do praise and worship for the Lord. Was he a poor man? Extremely poor. What did he do? For 6 months, he carried the imaginary organ, placed it on a table, opened a zip, and began to play and sing for the Lord. He could not hear the music, but in his heart, he's doing that every day in the morning. The wife is watching her. Nobody from the outside is watching him. The wife looking at him is thinking he's gone
mad.
Mad, correct. But he's going on doing it. Why? Because he saw it in the mirror. So he's predicting an organ to be released from the storeroom of God into his hands in the physical realm. Hello?
Yes.
So he's practicing it every day. And when he's practicing every day, an unknown man comes with an organ in his arms and says, take it. Now at least I can go to sleep in peace. So he realizes that what I'm speaking from here, because of faith, is going to the head office, and from the head office, it's going somewhere in the world and irritating that person to take that resources, buy the organ and deliver it at home.
Amen.
Yes.
So if an unknown stranger can deliver it to him, I can also sit in the place and say the same way and go, and that what I'm speaking by faith is going to somebody in this world, and that person has to come and give me. And that's exactly what happened. A person in Bombay, his name is Ronnie, he came past midnight to my house, knocked at my door and said, God woke me up and said, take this money and go and give it to him now, not even tomorrow, now. After midnight, he came to my house and gave me the money. And when we went to the market to check for the
keyboard,
keyboard, what we had even written down, we found the money in the envelope, the money over here, the stand, the cover, everything matched exactly the same. Not 1 rupee here, not 1 rupee here. And that's the time we began to understand the system. So now when I understood the system, what I'm doing in the secret, sitting with my laptop, talking to that organ, talking to the auditorium, talking to the camera, talking to the chairs, talking to the granite stones, talking to the hot water, solar system. Everything I'm talking. I don't have to go and search who is going to bring, because I've just using my faith and God is watching what I'm doing in my secret, looking into the mirror, exercising. God has already beamed somebody to come and give it to me. This has been happening for 22 years. I think you all did not hear. My voice is not going to you because nobody is replying to me. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Papa, I can hear.
Amen.
What happened to Jocelyn? She got knocked off?
Yes, Papa.
I can see you so small in your camera.
It's gone down like this.
I just went behind and sat like this.
The same system of faith, the person is not talking the promise, but talking the problem. Satan got his people also all around who do not even know they are working for Satan, and not now what you're imagining and what you're speaking. Satan is going to use those people to come and trouble you even more. So does that mean because of my mistake, my life is supposed to be miserable all my life?
No.
No. It is going to depend on whom? On me. Even though I made a mess, Can I repent? Yes. Can I make the correction?
Yes.
Can I plant the new seeds? Yes. So can I use my imagination? Yes. And when I'm using the imagination of looking into the mirror every day, now can I look into the mirror that my spouse has completely changed? Believe me, God is my witness. I used to go all over Bombay in those days to preach. During the morning time, I used to leave to the factory to work. Night time, I would come and then again go and do the work and do all those things. I was working at that time. And then I started my own business. Now, when I started my own business, from morning till 2 o'clock is business. 2 o'clock to past midnight is God's business. So what happens to the wife who sees her husband coming home every night after 2 o'clock? Hello?
Yes. Different thoughts.
Start coming home after 2 o'clock.
Some thoughts will come. Bad thoughts.
No. She knows that this fellow is going for this because now I've become very disciplined. Now I am mild. In those days, I was a wild man with the word of God. I was worse than a Rottweiler. Okay. On my way, I'm using my imagination. I'm using my imagination. When I'm reaching home, everything is peaceful. Everything is good and everything is fine. And I would speak on the bike over and over again. And I would go home and everything was fine.
Wow.
Okay. Praise God.
So God began to show me right from the beginning. Now when I read that for the first time, that in my name you shall cast out demons, it was 5 o'clock in the evening and I was crying. That picture is still in front of me. And when I went to meet the uncle the next day, I told him we can go and cast out demons. And it was during the prayer service, one person came and said, there's a lady who is possessed. And I said, see, it's come. Come on, let's go. And as I'm talking to him, there comes a lady. I don't know how to do it, but I've seen it in the Bible. And if I've seen it in the Bible, and if he says you can, then I can. How, I don't know, but I can, because he said I can. So he said, do you know how to do it? I said, no. So he said, how do you know then to go? I said, because it's written there, we can. And he said, when we go, what will we do? I said, I don't know, but let's go. We went there and we began to pray. Come on, we prayed and prayed and prayed. And in those days, we were praying with such volume, you know, because we were threatening the devil with a volume. And that girl was dancing in the house round and round and round and round. Last, we got tired. And we said, enough. She's not tired, we are tired. And we said, enough. And we said, let's go. And I came home and I started to cry. I said, you promised me that you said I can cast out. Then how come I did not do it? Please, I want to learn. He gave me a simple answer. He said, all answers are in the Bible. You go and find them. Wherever I'm casting out demons, whatever is being done, you study it. So I began to search the four Gospels and I began to write. My Bible, on the last page, I had stuck that, you know, in the Bible says, don't add any words. Don't subtract any words.
Yeah.
In my Bible, I had actually added pages and stuck it over there for all that for the demons to be cast out. Whatever passages are there, I stuck it there. And I told uncle, let's go now. So this time when we went, the girl started to do the same and I did not go to speak anything. I just opened all the scripture that I had prepared and I began to read it loudly. When I began to read it loudly, now I'm seeing that she is really getting tortured. She put her fingers inside and she ran straight away into the bedroom and locked it. So the mother went and banged. I did not even bother about that. She came and said, she has locked the door. I said, so what? No, she has locked the door. She can't hear it. I said, who wants her to hear it? I don't know about others, but if I make a prayer from here, not on the internet, and the person is in New York,
can't get that.
My word of life, the spirit of life will take my word and go and find the person who is in a mess and go and inject that life into that person and get that person into freedom. So this is only from the living room to the bedroom, yaar. Who is bothered? And when I said that, she opened the door and she came. And she came straight to me, knelt down and said, you are very powerful. Aha.
That's
she said, you are very powerful. I'm getting into a trap.
Yes.
I am not powerful.
The one who is in me is powerful.
And I said, I'm not powerful. But the one who is in me is powerful. And the one who is in me who is powerful, I take his name. His name is Jesus. And in his name, now get out. And it was just 2 minutes. She was all free. And she came back to her senses and she was delivered. So what I'm trying to say is, when you understand the system, it becomes so very easy. Praise God. Hallelujah.
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 So my willingness to use that scripture to actually go and become a person who is willing to cast out the demons. Where did I get that from? The mirror.
Amen.
So do I need somebody else to come and prophesy? Or do I need to take the word of God, look into the mirror and prophesy over myself that I shall cast out demons? And when I began to prophesy, I shall cast out demons, did God give me a chance to do it?
Yes.
So when I began to practice with God, did he give me success?
Yes.
So what is God looking for? People to be successful, or people who can look into the mirror and prophesy?
Look into the mirror and prophesy.
You know what you are saying? First let it become, then I can say I can cast out demons. Uh-huh. No. First your hand is not moving. You look into the mirror and say my hands are moving, and it's not moving. You keep on saying and prophesy and predict that it's happening. Why are you predicting? I'm predicting because it's written in the word. Now, based on that prediction, you're confident why it's in the word. Now, that prediction, your confidence in believing and speaking brings success.
Amen.
Now, for you, at least you had somebody to teach you. My time, I would see people doing, but nobody teaching how to do it. So I would be going and asking God, can you tell me how did he do it? Because when I'm doing it, it's not happening. So then I discovered, if I follow the system in the Bible, if I get the recipe right, then I can give the recipe to Marina and she can follow the recipe and she can also cook the mutton gravy.
Yes.
Because she followed the recipe. Now, Jude is not a cook, but he liked the gravy. And Marina said, I'll give you the recipe. So Jude goes and cuts the onion. He's all crying and all that. But he somehow cut it and he followed the instruction that was given. Jude, will the gravy become or no?
Yes.
Yes. Why? Because you stuck to the recipe. So Bible is Jesus's recipe of how he bash up the devil on this earth. And he's saying, I have given you not only the recipe, I've even given you my authority, my power. Now use it and be blessed and go and do it. Predict before it is happening. Believe before it's happening. And because you know the one whom you believe in, that is not a liar, and you're stepping out in faith, you will see the manifestation.
Amen. Hallelujah.
That's why I always say you need guts to believe. You need guts to predict. You need guts to step out in faith. You need guts. Yes, imagination too. Where did you get that imagination? From what was heard. Now, for example, Now, for example, Marina, just a question. You are a woman, so let me ask a woman. Supposing a woman has been given, the husband comes and says, this time's bonus, I'm going to give it to you. And you do whatever you want with the money. And the husband always keeps his word. He spoke 5 months in advance. Will the wife wait till the 5 months are over and the money comes, or has she already made a plan?
Yes, already made a plan.
Really? And if the money is about 2 lakhs?
Big plan.
So she's making plans. I will buy a lipstick. I'll buy chocolate.
Plans.
Huh?
Diamonds.
You can hear what Saru is saying?
Yeah. Diamonds.
If the husband is keeping his word, surely. But the money has not come in the hand.
But if he's keeping his promise, I know for sure the money will come now.
But what about the other husband who is saying 4 lakhs but never keeps his word?
Then better not make any plans.
Swarup, 4 lakhs this time. 5 months, 4 lakhs, but he does not keep his word.
Let it come, then I'll see.
He's not even talking now. If you want to ask about anything about imagination, go and ask the woman. They can imagine so wonderful that they can be in the house, but they have already gone into the shopping mall.
And we found also what we want.
We men, when we go to the show, go to buy a shirt, we'll say, okay, whatever 2 shirts have come, we'll pick up one. Have you ever traveled with a woman to a shopping mall?
Yeah.
But you have got a woman who is spiritual. Forget it. You should go to a woman who is expert in shopping. My God, how many shops, man? So if a woman can do that imagination, imagine the same woman doing shopping in the Bible and making online shopping where the promises are given. You pick up those promises online and start placing the order. And the best thing in this shopping, nothing to be paid, paid in full by Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
What Raul was doing was he was doing online shopping.
Amen.
Online shopping, do they show you the product or the picture of the product?
The picture of the product.
And based on that picture, you are already imagining how the product is?
Yeah.
In the same way,
the Bible reviews also.
Of heaven shopping storehouse. Okay. He is saying these are the promises. Now, are we interested in online shopping of the kingdom of God or what this world is giving?
To be honest,
the world is giving.
If once you understand, when somebody said, I don't do online shopping, the day you understand the online shopping of the kingdom of God is so powerful that whatever you're doing, even in your toilet, God can still answer prayers. In the midst of all that pain, you are still on online shopping with God. Everything is getting downloaded. And the best part is you don't make any payment. The payment has been made by Jesus for you, and everything you receive as a free gift from God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Third thing we learned about Raul in this testimony is he became confident and called up his friends and said, tomorrow you will see me. And it did not happen. So he was forcing the miracle, but not forcing his confidence in the imagination and allowing God to do it in his time. He repeated again and again, and he found it's not working. And then he learned, it is not my timing, it is God's timing. Is that right?
Yes.
Now, did he stay in discussion with his friends? Or did he isolate himself from everybody?
Isolated.
Hello?
Isolated.
So he began to realize that even though I called up my friends who don't understand spiritual, I told them, tomorrow you'll see my hand perfect. It did not happen. Again he tried. It did not happen. Again he tried. It did not happen. It was discouragement. But yet, he was not ready to stay in that environment with his friends. But he went back. He went back to the same environment of the CD, which was giving him the truths of the kingdom of God. Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God. Praise God.
If he had to stay in an environment with his friends, would that magnify his problem?
Yes. Yes.
Again, again, again. His friends were very close to him. Would they talk to him about his problem?
Yes.
Yes.
Would they talk to him what the doctor said?
Yes.
Yes.
So would that magnify his problem?
Yes.
Yes.
So he made a decision. I am not interested in staying in this environment. I would rather go and stay alone and create an environment of God's presence using the teaching. I'm not fellowshipping with anybody, but I'm fellowshipping with the teaching where the Lord is speaking back to me. Just because I failed, God is saying, it's okay, you failed, but my system doesn't change. Get into the system again. Just because you failed in cycling and you fell down, doesn't mean you stay there looking at the bleeding, what happened on the pain. Get on the cycle again. Come on, get on the cycle again. So he got back to his house. Again, he started the same thing. Praise God.
Praise God. Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God.
The moment he changed his environment from his problem to spiritual mirror, the spiritual mirror began to magnify the Lord and made the problem so small that one day it disappeared and he did not even realize when. For example, I told you about my legs, which were in pain when I fell down, did not go to the doctor. But when I went to US to be with my wife and children, and there I was in the church, and the Lord said, your hand got delivered in 2 days. Your legs did not get delivered because they were swollen at the knees for such a long time. But did you realize when you got healed? I said, no, Lord, I did not even realize when I got healed. But are you healed? I said, yeah, I'm healed. I can kneel down, no problem. So he said, do you know why you did not realize you got healed? Because you never kept looking at the problem. You kept looking at me. You kept looking at what was the assignment before you. And you kept yourself so busy in that, you did not even realize when it got healed. When you are in God's environment, all your weaknesses are dying. When you're out of God's environment and you're in a problem environment, all your weaknesses are magnifying. So it's your decision where you want to remain. And Roald, thank God, he had known the word of God before. He said, the only person where I can get my healing is not even Papa Johnson, but the teaching that I've got, when God is talking to me, let me remain there and magnify the Lord. When I'm magnifying the Lord, the problems are dying by default. When I'm magnifying my problems and telling God, when will I get healed? You have never magnified God. You are magnifying your problems. By the wounds of Jesus, I'm healed. By the wounds of Jesus, I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Now, even though you're saying 100 times, 1,000 times, you are only talking about healing. Should I continue?
Yes, yes.
Yes, Papa.
Is it helping you?
Yes.
Yes.
Are you learning the secrets?
Yes.
These are hidden secrets, hidden principles inside which he practiced. It was discouraging because it did not produce the result. But staying in that atmosphere strengthened him to move in that direction and weakened those symptoms to the time the symptoms were washed out completely and he did not even know when. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, let's come to the fourth one. He has got bashed up. Memory is gone. Memory is come. When the memory has come back, it is a proof that his problem is not permanent. It is just a temporary. The secret is, whatever you are feeling right now, let's take for example, Marina, that day you spoke about hurt. It's a feeling. The good news is, your feelings are never permanent.
Yes.
Your feelings can change any moment based on the way you think. And if Jesus says, I've come to give you life, life in abundance. So how do I receive life? I receive life by receiving his word. Because he said, my word is spirit and
truth
and life. My word is spirit and life. Correct? So if he is getting into the word and looking into the mirror day and night, called the word, is the word and the spirit all the time together?
Yes.
So when the word and the spirit are together and is spending too much time with the word, is the spirit actually working inside of him and changing his life?
Yes.
So just because I saw the symptom, which is giving me a negative emotion, my negative emotion or my feelings are never life. The word is life.
Yes, yes.
I can have a negative emotion, but that's not my life. My life is based on the word.
Yes.
So if I can get the word and spend the time with the word and get that word like a Rottweiler, my feelings can be negative right now, but it's not temporary, but it's not permanent. And if I can stay on that word for a long time, it has the power to change my feelings. And the lie of the devil was saying, this is how your life will be. You know, you got married to a wrong person and that wrong person is torturing you. That's going to be your life. Look at your feelings. That's going to be your life. That's the biggest lie. Your feelings are never your life. Your feelings are your, the word is your life. If the root is right, your feelings will be right.
Yes.
The root produces the fruit.
Yes.
So the devil is going to do is he's going to show you all the negative things that are happening and saying this is going to be a permanent life, which is the biggest lie. You and I have the freedom to pick up the seed and choose the seed. And God, thank God for Jesus, who has given us the written seed with a signature on and is saying this seed is incorruptible. What is corruptible is your heart. So if you can get this right, don't worry about this. This is excellent. If you can get this right by planting over here and making this one and this one the same, life will flow through you, which will change your feelings, which will change your thinking, which will change your decision, which will change your actions, which will change your future, which will change everything in your life.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Now, was there an advantage of making me mute? If Jocelyn had to say, today I'll keep him mute, I would be sitting and screaming and screaming. But because you unmute, am I giving you seeds?
Yes.
Are those seeds going to make an effect in your future?
Yes. Yes.
So can you decide whom to mute in your life?
Yes.
Come on, you got many contacts. Hello, you got many contacts. in the midst of your problem, you should be very selective in whom to mute,
whom to listen,
whom to unmute.
Amen.
If your selection goes wrong, your future will go wrong.
Praise God.
So Raul understood, I have to mute my friends and unmute the teachings. I don't need my friends now because they are not capable of solving my problem. Yeah, my friends are good for some other situation, but not for this. You are not invited in this situation because you are incapable to help me in this situation. Yes, there are times when you are capable of, but not in this situation. For this situation, I have to unmute and keep that unmute on for my God, because he is the master over all situations.
Amen. Amen.
And if you know that what I'm talking is from the word of God, you better keep me unmute.
Yes.
Because it was okay for me, you to unmute me, to mute me when it is tongues, because in tongues, there is no understanding. Everybody is speaking. It is coming from the Holy Ghost. That's why even I said, okay, let it be okay. Because anyway, that prayer is perfect. It is not, there's no imperfection in that. I did not even try.
Yes.
Lesson learned.
Isn't that a wonderful lesson?
Yeah, Papa. Yes.
So do we have some people that you have to mute?
Yes, definitely.
So what about the person who is constantly giving you fear?
Mute.
Stay away for a period, for a season, till you get your thing strong. And now when he opens his mouth, you open your mouth with the word of God. Praise God. Yes. You start speaking the truths. And whatever he's speaking, but what is coming out of your mouth? Continuous truth. Is it going to enter that? Yes. Will it have an effect? Yes. So the real calculation in our life is have the connections in such a way, you know when to mute somebody, you know when to unmute somebody.